But it's funny because James is really, I think, one of the first books in the Bible that I actually sat down and read. And it's all about action. All about action, listening and doing. So as we go through this message tonight, think about what you're doing. We're going to pray. Father God, thank you for everything you're doing in our hearts and lives. Thank you for the renewing of our minds. Continue to open our hearts and minds to what your word has to say. Give us strength and courage to continue on the narrow path that you have us on. We honor you and we praise you in Jesus' name. So again, we're in James chapter 2. I'm going to read verse 14 to 26 first. Okay, what good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith, but don't show it by your actions? Can that kind of faith save anyone? Suppose you see a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, and you say goodbye and have a good day, stay warm and eat well, but then you don't give that person any food or clothing. What good does that do? So you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Unless it produces good deeds, it is dead and useless. Now someone may argue, some people have faith, others have good deeds. But I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? I will show you my faith by my good deeds. You say you have faith, for you believe there is one God. Good for you. Even the demons believe this, and they tremble in terror. How foolish. Can't you see that faith without good deeds is useless? Don't you remember that our ancestor Abraham was shown to be right with God by his actions when he offered his son Isaac to the altar? You see, his faith and his actions worked together. His actions made his faith complete. And so it happened just as the scripture said. Abram believed God, and God counted him as righteous because of his faith. He was even called the friend of God. So you see, we are shown to be right with God by what we do, not by faith alone. Rahab the prostitute is another example. She was shown to be right with God by her actions when she hid those messengers and sent them safely away by a different road. Just as the body is dead without breath, so also faith is dead without good works. I think that's a really good message. Really powerful message, especially for recovery. I want to start off by saying that James does not contradict Paul. Some see a difference between Paul's salvation by faith and James's salvation is faith plus works. Ephesians 2, 8, 9, it says, God saved you by his grace when you believed. Thank you. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. Now I'm going to go on to verse 10. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Paul dogmatically says that justification is by faith alone. We are saved by faith. I'm thankful for that. When I got and understood the depth of what the gospel meant for me, I was very grateful. Gratitude to me is an action word. I can't sit here and say how grateful I am to Jesus for what he's done. I need to show my gratitude. James here is arguing against the belief that a person can have faith without producing any good works. Verse 17 and 18 says, so you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Unless it produces good deeds, it is dead and useless. So faith without works is dead. Just as faith can be alive, faith can also be dead. And dead faith is faith that doesn't prove itself in action. That's what James is all about, action, listening, and doing. A lot of you here have heard my past stories. I had a rough life. I had a rough upbringing. I was a rough person. I was caught in an addiction for a long time. Ended up going to prison, like soccer mom going Muncie. That's my story. Okay, fighting, all that stuff. You know, on the streets, all the stuff that comes along with the addiction is my story too. I remember the day I got saved, and it was in a church down the street. And listen, hindsight's a beautiful thing because I know God has been chasing my butt for many, many years, okay? But I'll never forget the moment that my heart changed. Tonight's about a heart call. Like, in my heart, I got what he did for me. I cried. I was overwhelmed because until that moment, looking back on my past, I was, I don't want to say it because I don't look at myself like that. I just looked at myself as a lost soul, is what I was, mean, nasty. We talk about total transformation. We need to change, especially in recovery. There's things that we need to do. In here, Bob goes over a step a month. Don't just listen to what he says. Don't just listen when they're up here sharing. Don't just listen. This, what is it? We listen to hear, right? I listened for a long time. Sometimes the hearing part comes later. You know, it was like hitting a brick wall. I heard what they were saying. You know, and in that moment, I had a heart change. And I start, listen, it's, I didn't let go of everything all at one time. He's been working on me for years, and I still have a lot of work to do. I am, and by far perfect in any way, shape, or form. In the beginning, you know, I remember raising my hand and confessing that I believed. I remember going up to the altar so everybody could see, everybody else could see. I believed. Get clout. But for a long time, there was no change. It was an empty profession of faith. An empty profession of faith. Just so everybody could see what I was doing. That's ego. Come on, let's face it. Pat me on the back. That's, listen, I'm going to be truthful about myself. Full of pride and ego. It was always what, like, you know, would show, I would do things to show everybody. And I'm a Christian. Who are you when no one's looking? Because that's who you really are. What if, how am I talking to my kids when they're getting on my nerves? How am I talking to my husband? You know, am I showing everybody on the outside that everything's great, we're happily married, and then I go home and the words that come out of my mouth, I can't do that. So when the thoughts pop into my head with the words that want to come out, I bite my tongue. That's one of the best lessons I can learn. Bite my tongue, not say anything. Not say anything. Easy believism is a word I just learned about. And for a long time, that's what I wanted. Yes, I believe, and then go on to be the carnal Christian, you know, living in all this sin and using drugs and getting high and drinking and carrying on with my sex life like I always did. But I'm saved. That didn't work out for me. It got me wrecking cars and wrecking lives, almost dying in state prison. It was in a jail cell. It's my surrender. Was in, I went to county and I ended up getting put in a turtle suit. They put me in the insane asylum because I lost it. They didn't give me anything to come off of the drugs and the withdrawal. I was sick, couldn't smell food. I was losing it. So they turtle suited me, put me in a cell. They don't turn the lights out. There was no pillow, no books, no pencils, no nothing. It was just me in this turtle suit. And hearing The things that I heard while I was in that cell made me crazier than I was. And I remember a couple days of just sitting on that floor and rocking and pulling the hairs out of my eyebrows, my eyelashes, my hair, just pulling them because I was this close to really losing it, smashing my head up against that concrete wall like the other girl was doing. And hearing them screaming out and the cat calls and it was bad. And I remember they're sitting there and it was the moment before I was ready to start smashing my head up against the wall. And I look up on the door, the cell door, and somebody had scratched out, "My God will get me out of this." Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You want to talk about like a heartfelt moment. I had never felt in my life before that moment peace. Total peace and warmth. It's like he took his arms and wrapped them around me. And I knew I was going to be okay. I was saved years before that, right? But it was that moment in my heart I knew that he had me. So again, my pride and ego kick in. And I was like, I got that, right? So God's going to get me out of this. That cell door is going to open now. And I must have went another day saying, God's going to get me out of this. And every time I pointed at the door, I swore it was going to open, and it didn't. So there's me trying to control things again, right? It's total surrender. I can't control anything. So it was really when I finally got up off the floor and I got into bed exhausted. Now, I was in there for 5 days, and I didn't sleep. I was hallucinating, feeling things crawling on me. But I got up into bed, and I was really at peace. You know, flashing through everything that I did, knowing that everything was going to be okay, getting to a place that, you know what, God, whatever's going to happen is going to happen. The time that my lawyer told me that I was supposed to do if I got the mandatory minimum for every felony was 45 years. Mm-hmm. But you know, but it was at that moment that I, whatever it's going to be, like I did some rotten things. I deserve to be in prison. I was never mad at the judge or the cops or anything like that. I deserved prison, and I was okay with whatever sentence that he thought I needed. But I got blessed with a 2-4 and a 5-year tail, so I'm still on paper, right? 9 years out of my life it's going to be. November, I'll be done. But that no hots, no trouble. I don't even have to go in much and check in. It's pretty cool. But it has nothing to do with me. That moment in that jail cell, right, when I realized that he was with me and that he had me and I felt it in my heart of hearts, is the moment that I was grateful to be alive. And that was the first time throughout many years of addiction that I was grateful to be alive. Because there was many days that I cursed God every day that I woke up breathing. Mm-hmm. Couldn't understand why I was alive. And it was there in jail, and upstate, I changed. Little things here and there. Well, listen, when I first went upstate, the hustle was still there. You know, that it takes time. It took me time. Not everything went overnight, but it was one thing at a time. And the first thing I had to work on was being sober. Because without being sober, all this and the heart that I have today is gone. So first and foremost was sobriety. Getting into the Word of God and letting the Holy Spirit really work through me. He convicted me of things throughout the years. I'm still getting convicted of things, but like I said, for me, I got to work on one thing at a time. Because when I started working all this stuff, after all these years, listen, I'm 47 years old, so there's a whole lot of years of stuff that I had to work on, one thing at a time. And that he's been. Every year, I'm working on something else. Every year, listen, if faith can be alive, it can be dead. Dead faith is belief that does not prove itself in action. It claims to be something it's not. What are you doing? Are you working towards your recovery? Are you still stuck in the same behaviors? The behaviors are what's going to get you. Turning our lives over to God always requires action. always. Okay, James is emphasizing the point that genuine Christian faith in Christ will produce a changed life. Where is your heart? We can raise our hands for prayer. We can come up to the altar call because everybody's looking and it's expected of us. But change nothing. So where is your heart? That's what tonight is all about. Where is your heart? Empty professions of faith have no power to change lives. James is not saying that justification is by faith plus works, but rather that a person who is truly justified by faith will have good works in their life. Works are not the cause of salvation, but are the evidence of salvation. We are not saved by something we do, but by something God does. That's the root of salvation. But salvation has more than roots. It has fruits.
Amen.
Obedience is the fruit of salvation. Those who obey God's word really do love him. Gratitude is an action word. I am so grateful to God for what he's done for me. So grateful to Christ for what he's done on that cross for me. So what have I done these past few years? I've worked on changing, staying sober, loving, being kind, being compassionate. I am not that person without the Spirit of God in me. I am not. And when I go trying to run the show and do things on my own, which I go back and forth, pride and ego are things I still have to work on, then I don't bear fruit. But I know real quick when I'm running on me and when it's Tracy's show, or when I'm running with God's Spirit and it's God's show. Because there's a difference. True saving faith will result in a transformed life. How we live reveals what we believe. How are you living? And I'm going to be quiet just a couple seconds. How are you living? How are you talking to people? How are you when no one's looking? That was a hard one for me. Who you are when no one's looking. Because that's who you really are. Because for the most part, for a long time, when nobody was looking, I was still not nice. It's work, okay? It's work. James 2 tells us that an empty profession of faith, one that does not result in a life of obedience to Christ, is in reality a dead faith that cannot save. Faith without works is dead because it reveals a heart that has not been transformed by God. Where is your heart? When we have been generated by the Holy Spirit, our lives will demonstrate a new life. Listen, and I think Dave said it earlier, the first step is confessing. I want to read Romans. Romans chapter 10, I'm going to read verse 9 and 10. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Thank you. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God, and it is by confessing with your mouth that you are saved. We have to confess and we have to believe in our hearts. That's why I'm asking, where is your heart? Because we can do a lot of things because people are looking, and it's something they're supposed to do. This moment, this meeting tonight is really you and God. God knows where your heart is. Nobody in here can tell you where your heart is. Seriously, think about it. What are you feeling right now? Feeling that tug? You have that heart change. It's hard to go back to being who you once were. talked a lot about the heart in action tonight. Have you confessed but not changed? Tonight is a heart call. Where's your heart? Do you feel the Spirit of God tugging on your heart tonight, telling you that some things need to change? Can you feel that? If you do, please raise your hand. With every head bowed, no one peeking, I'd like to see a show of hands. Who've had a heart call tonight? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else? Father God, you know whose heart has been pierced tonight. Whether they raise their hand or not, you know. Holy Spirit, I ask you to continue to tug on their hearts. Help them with obedience. Help them stay on this path of transformation. Give them the strength to keep on, to push past it. Give them the courage to continue their walk beside you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Useless. If we believe in the principles of recovery, but refuse to act upon them, we are not in recovery. If we believe God can help us, but refuse to obey His will, we prove that our faith is dead. True faith in God expresses itself in committed actions. Our actions need to back up our words if we want to succeed in recovery. So there's a lot of things, like it's about being honest, you know, not cheating, not stealing, not lying. It's about a lot of things and a whole lot of change. For me, that scared me. I didn't know how to change. Listen, I went to Muncie at 38 years old. I started drinking and getting high at 12. Well, at 15 years old, I was learning how to play with brass knuckles, knives, and nunchucks. So there's a mentality. My entire life, I got out of prison at 40. Jeez, 40 years old. One day at a time. One thing at a time. You know, focusing on one thing at a time, but really getting into the Word. Letting Him pierce my heart. Letting the Holy Spirit work through me and convict me of the things that needed to be changed. And not denying that conviction. Not running from. He's convicted me over every year. It's something new. And I know every year until the day I die, it's going to be something we're talking about until I'm in heaven. Listen, I got all kinds of faults and flaws and shortcomings and defects. And, you know, you can't work on everything. Let Him do the work. That's what it was. I surrendered. I let Him work through me. It was nothing I did.
That's how it works, man.
But I just told, listen, mentors, taking suggestions, doing the things they actually told me to do, like praying. Like, instead of just saying, yeah, I'm praying, now I'm actually praying. Because in the beginning, that's all I had.